church say amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you so much, Brother Harris and Ben and all of those who are leading us by way of music, to all of the preachers who have assembled here in this pulpit, to my wife Savannah, who's reminded me to just go preach like I always would. To this Floyd family that has gathered both hither and yonder. That's just an old school way to say near and far, y'all. That's all that means. To Bridget, who I sat down at the table that we might plan this homegoing celebration. And it is my prayer that it has been the celebration that your heart desired. Now listen, I'm a Southern preacher, so I'm here to serve you some soul food. 1 Kings chapter 18. Just a few verses there. And family, that we share in these verses, share in this moment, that God might bless our soul as we process this tragedy and the loss of the life of Brother George Floyd. In 1 Kings chapter 18, reading verse 42 to verse 44, this is what it says. It said, so Ahab went up to eat and drink. Some of y'all wish y'all were with him. And Elijah, come on, y'all wake up in here. And Elijah went up to the top of Carmel. Then he bowed down on the ground and put his face between his knees. He prayed, y'all. And he said to his servant, go up now. Look towards the sea. So he went up and looked and said, there is nothing. And seven times he said, go again. Verse 44, then it came to pass the seventh time that he said, there is a cloud as a small man's hand rising out of the sea. So he said, go up and say to Ahab, prepare your chariot and go down before the rain stops. Let me give a quick synopsis of what I just read, just to make sure that we're all on the same page for this eulogistic moment. There's a prophet of God. This prophet of God has been promised a miracle by God. They're in a drought, and the land is suffering because of the drought. This prophet Elijah tells his servant to go up and survey the land and look for any signs that the drought is about to be over. And every time he goes to look and survey the land, he has no distinguishing signs or evidence that the drought is about to be over. And here is the difficult thing about his task. He has to keep on looking even though he sees nothing. And here's the dilemma. Here is the plight of God's servant. He has to keep praying. He has to keep being faithful. He has to keep looking and seeing nothing. It's his responsibility to keep praying, to keep looking and seeing nothing. Can you imagine the weight of that responsibility to know there's a miracle on the way, safe and security from the drought, and yet every time you look, Floyd family, you've been praying, you've been looking, and still you see nothing. So too is the plight of why we're here today. He's the reason why we're here. All because something was different about that day. What was so different about that day? His name was George Floyd. And I heard his brother in Minneapolis say, come on, say his name. Somebody say George Floyd. Perry's what they call him. He's a brother, a son, a father. And it took 8 minutes and 46 seconds for him to die in broad daylight with the whole world watching. And although it took 8 minutes and 46 seconds for him to die, it took 401 years for the system to put it in place that nothing would happen. And as we watched this man die. As we watched in horror and shock at the life leave his body, as he told the world, I cannot breathe. Three conversations happened. He died and three conversations happened. First conversation that happened within Black America. It was the conversation that we've had similar before. It was the conversation that you had family before. It was the conversation I had with my friend Mike in Chicago, Corey in New York, Ben in Atlanta, Eddie in Alabama, and Nathan in Charlotte. It's the same conversation we've had before. It's the same conversation my wife has had with her friends. It's the same conversation you have had with your friends. It's the same conversation that happens within Black America time and time again. We start out the conversation, they kill him, man. It's in broad daylight. They even got it on tape this time. They took that man's life, but something was different about that day. What was so different? His name was George Floyd. Somebody say George Floyd. Perry is what they call him. This man, this son, this brother, this father, this gentle giant. And I wonder how many times this gentle giant got asked what basketball team he played for, what football team he played for, because brothers, you know how it is. If you're tall and you're black, you gotta play on somebody's team. And in that conversation within Black America, as we called around, as we text around, we were already dealing with Ahmaud Arbery. We were already shaken by what happened to Breonna Taylor in her own home. We were already shaken by what happened to Christian Cooper, to see a white woman weaponize her whiteness with such ease and efficiency. We were already shaken, and then before we could even come to emotional terms with all of that, here's Perry Jr., George Floyd, this man, this son, this brother, this father, this gentle giant, life being taken, light being extinguished, 8 minutes and 45 seconds, but it was 401 years in the making. You know, we were all understandable, Black America. We were all understandably shocked, but at the same time, we didn't really expect anything to happen. We've seen this happen before. We've seen life be taken on camera before. And even though we were outraged and upset, we began to think to ourselves, this is going to be just like everything else, and nothing is going to happen. So y'all know how it is, y'all. We don't let ourselves get emotionally invested in the case. We don't follow it as closely as we would, because after all, why let ourselves get the hope that white supremacy will finally be dealt with? They haven't dealt with it before. Why begin to hope for justice? They haven't given us justice before. Why begin to hope for change? They haven't given us change before. And where we would normally end those conversations within Black America, where we would normally begin to turn our emotions off, where we would normally try to save ourselves from the heartache of hoping that change and justice could come, that day we didn't turn our emotions off. That day was different. What was so different about that day? His name was George Floyd. Somebody say George Floyd. Perry Jr. is what they call him. A man, a brother, a son, a father, a gentle giant, a banana and mayonnaise sandwich eating man. Who in the world? That day, those conversations in Black America did not end the same. We didn't end them with the same despair, because on that day, a fire of civil rights was relit in this nation. It began to burn within the hearts and souls of every Black American, whether we were in the country, whether we were in cities, whether we were on the East Coast or West Coast, something in our nation began to happen. We began to say, lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. We said that if I have to scream it from the valley, if I have to yell it from the mountaintops, if I have to march in the streets, if I have to protest, something's got to change. Because something was different about that day. What was so different? His name was George Floyd. Perry Jr., what they call him. Not only did his death start another conversation that ended differently in within black conversations, but also I gotta share what his death sparked, the conversation black parents had to have with their black children. The conversations we have to have, they were different that day. You know the weight every black parent knows. The heavy burden of having to go to our children and talk to them about seeing another black body killed on the streets. And we all knew that we had to go have a conversation with them. I mean, after all, everybody was seeing it, everybody was talking it, because that day was different. What was so different about that day? His name was George Floyd. Perry Jr., what they call him. We knew our children had watched that 8 minute and 46 second long video, and we did not have the luxury to act like they didn't have to deal with it. Black America, we went to go talk to our children. You never will forget the pain you see in your child's eyes when you have to explain to them that people hate them just because of the color of their skin. You never will forget, black parents, the depth of innocence in their eyes as they have to come to terms with the fact that there are some people out there that hate them simply because they were born with brown skin. But something was different about that day. What was so different? His name was George Floyd. Somebody say George Floyd. Perry Jr., what they call him. A brother, a son, a father, a gentle giant, a banana and mayonnaise sandwich eating man, a man who growing up had to dry clothes in the oven. Thank God they didn't catch on fire. Amen. So black parents had to go to their children, and have a conversation with them to help them not be worried and not lose even more innocence as a child than they've already lost. Right. So many of us had to game plan and strategize what we would say. Right. Before we went to go talk to them, we told ourselves, I know what we'll say. We'll say that things are getting better. And deep down, we had to even question that ourselves, are things getting better? If I'm having the same conversation about black bodies being killed in the streets that my father had with me, that his father had with him, that his mother had with him, are things getting better? So you say to yourself, okay, when you go in, make sure that you say it with conviction so that your child can have innocence just a little while longer. Something was different about that day. That day when you would normally go to your child and just say to them, well, things are getting better. That day that you would normally just go to them and give them a hug and try to console them. Something was different about that day. What was so different? His name was George Floyd. Perry Jr., what they call him. A brother, a son, a gentle giant, a banana and mayonnaise sandwich eating man, a dry and clothes in the oven man, I asked his little brother to make a grilled cheese sandwich man. Something was different about that day. We were tired of being tired. Yes, sir. And we began to sing that old song, I don't feel no ways tired. Come too far from where I started from. Nobody told me the road would be easy. But God has brought us too far to leave us now. We had a different conversation. We went to our child and we said, I've had enough. Our children's lives matter. Our children will not be the next hashtag. Our children will not be the next face that somebody changes on their social media profile. Enough is enough. If I have to demand legislation change, we will. If we have to meet with sheriffs, we will. If we have to meet with police chiefs, we will. If we have to yell it from the valley, scream it from the mountaintops, march in the streets and protest, we will. Enough is enough. We are sick of seeing our children dead in the streets. Enough is enough. The conversation ended that day differently because something was different about that day. That's the conversation Black America had within itself. That's the conversation Black parents had with their Black children. Then the last conversation is the conversation that this nobody of a preacher had with God. They killed him that day. I had to talk to my 8-year-old son who thought I'd be mad at him because he heard that a man died at the hands of police. My 8-year-old thought I'd be mad at him because he knew about it. My 8-year-old, innocence gone, now knows that people hate him just because his skin is brown. But something was different about that day. Something was different about that day. There's nobody of a preacher in Fayetteville, North Carolina. I prayed to the Lord.
That's right.
Because something was different about that day. What was so different about that day?
Let's see.
His name was George Floyd.
George Floyd. That's right.
Perry Jr. What they call him.
That's right.
A brother, a son. A father, a gentle giant, a banana and mayonnaise sandwich eating man, dry clothes in the oven, boy, asked his little brother to make a grilled cheese sandwich for him. A man happy that LeBron James came back and won, even though Golden State looked like they were running away with it. They killed him. And that's why we can't hashtag jog. That's why we can't hashtag cookout. That's why we can't hashtag eat ice cream in our own apartment. That's why we can't hashtag birdwatch. That's why we can't hashtag shop while Black. That's why we can't hashtag drive while Black. That's why we can't hashtag live. And I pray. This nobody of a preacher pray. What do you post? What do you tweet? What do you say to prove your own humanity to people? You got people that believe in Sasquatch. They go out in the woods every season looking for Sasquatch because they believe he exists, and yet at the same time will tell you racism ain't real. What do you say to prove your humanity to people? What do you tweet? What do you post? What do you say to prove your humanity to people? You got people right now that believe in Loch Ness Monster with all their heart because they saw a fuzzy picture from 70 years ago. And yet when a Black person tells them racism is real, they're discredited. What do you do? What do you do? But I kept on praying. I saw George Floyd, Perry, what they call him. I saw him die. My son saw him die. His family had to watch him die. I kept on praying. I kept on praying. Even though when I looked out at the nation, I saw nothing that shattered the pattern of having that conversation with our kids. And seeing the innocence die in their eyes. But I kept on praying. I kept on praying because I didn't see the legislation that was going to hold bad police officers accountable. But I kept on praying. And honestly, I felt like Elijah's servant. See, y'all forgot I read scripture at the beginning. I felt like Elijah's servant who was told a miracle is coming. And every time he went up to check the landscape, he saw nothing. I've been praying. Lord, I've been faithful. Lord, I've been looking out across the landscape of America. Lord, the Floyd family has been praying. They have been faithful. They have been looking out across the landscape of America, out at the landscape. And do you know what I expected to see? Nothing. Nothing to help eradicate the system of white supremacy. Nothing to eradicate systemic racism that's killing us. And when I thought I'd see nothing, when I thought I'd see no miracle, when I thought I'd see no hand of God, when I thought I'd see no justice for George Floyd, when I thought when Black Lives Matter, it wouldn't matter because people would just say, well, all lives matter. When I thought we could have a conversation about what we need to do about bad cops, I knew somebody would just say, but what about black on black crime? When I thought I'd see nothing because those who shed tears, yep, there are those that will shed tears over the American flag being on the ground, but won't think twice about a black man being killed in the streets. I thought I'd see nothing. I thought I'd see just another chorus of those offended by blacks kneeling on the grass. They got stuff to say about blacks kneeling on the grass, but ain't got nothing to say about an officer kneeling on a man's neck. I thought I'd see nothing. I thought I'd see nothing from that same crowd that they can see the nuance. They'll say, well, you know, a few bad cops don't make all cops bad, but then they'll tell you a few bad protesters make all protesters bad. I thought I'd look at the nation and see nothing. But I dared to hope. I dared to have faith. Hoping that this time when I looked up across the mountaintop to survey the landscape of America, I hope that I'd see something when every other time I looked and I'd seen nothing. I said amen from my conversation with God. Floyd family, you said amen from your conversation with God. And we look across the American landscape, and just like the servant, that nameless servant in the Bible, when we look across the landscape of America, I see it.
I see it.
It's off in the distance.
I see it.
It's small, but it's moving this way.
Yeah, yeah. Moving this way.
I see it. I see white evangelicals who are usually silent during racist times beginning to speak up against the hate of racism. Yeah. I see God's hand moving this way. I looked and I saw protests had started. And when the camera zoomed in, I saw there were as many white faces and as many Hispanic faces and there were black faces. We were all coming together in unity for humanity. And I looked and I saw God's hand moving this way. I looked, Floyd family, and they arrested not just one of the officers, but they arrested all four officers that took George Floyd's life. I looked and I saw God's hand coming this way. I saw police taking the knee. I saw a sheriff calling out other sheriffs. I saw the military take off their riot gear and walk with people. I saw God's hand coming this way. I saw the Scholar brothers, the comedians. I saw that they had children that made signs. And when hateful people took down their signs, our Jewish brothers and sisters went back up and put the signs back up. I see God's hand moving this way. The American Academy of Pediatrics posted on Twitter on Sunday night that racism is a public health issue. I see God's hand moving this way. Ben and Jerry's Ice Cream said it's time to dismantle white supremacy. I see God's hand moving this way. Ohio wants to declare racism a statewide emergency. I see God's hand moving this way. Taylor Swift came through and said to all her millions of followers that we gotta stop letting racism rule this nation. Even Taylor Swift came through. France is marching with us. Germany is marching with us. Canada is marching with us. The United Kingdom is marching with us. I looked and when I thought I'd see nothing, I saw the hand of God moving this way. Because our nation has been in a drought for far too long. We've been in a drought from love. We've been in a drought from peace. We've been in a drought from hope. We've been in a drought from equality. We've been in a drought, but I got good news today. The children of God are beginning to rise up in this nation. I got good news today. I see the hand of God moving this way. And when the hand of God gets here, I believe he'll bring about a glorious rain. And the rain will wash away all the deep-seated hate of racism. The rain will wash away police brutality. The rain will wash away injustice. The rain will wash away the fear that keeps us separated. The rain will wash away the stereotypes that magnify the worst in us. I got good news today. There was something different about that day. There was something different about that day. I hear somebody saying, what's so different about that day? His name is Jesus. He still sits on the throne. And when George Floyd took his last breath, the reason this family can still have peace is because his name is Jesus and no other help I know. Is there anybody in here that can say, I'm so glad I found a Savior and his name is Jesus. He's my strength. He's my hope. He's my rock. And that's why his death won't be in vain. That's why we'll keep saying his name. George Floyd, Perry Jr., what they call him. When he took his last breath, I believe he said like Jesus said, Father, into thy hand I commend my spirit. And I got good news today. A movement is happening in America. A movement is happening in America. A movement is happening in America. And I'm glad that all of us get to say that it was George Floyd that sparked the fuse. It was George Floyd, Perry Jr., what they call him, who sparked the fuse that's going to change this nation.
God bless you.